Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the Bombay Chamber of Commerce and Industry and myself, I would like to express my sincere thanks to all of you for accepting our invitation and gracing today's webinar on the forthcoming union budget with the specific topic as to how will the budget 2021 impact the economy in the aftermath of COVID-19. I wish it was already the aftermath, but sadly it doesn't look like it is the aftermath. It may be a while before we are actually done with the COVID-19 outbreak. But nevertheless, the union budget for 2021-22 is expected to be announced by the finance minister on 1st February 2021. The COVID-19 outbreak and ensuing lockdowns have had severe economic consequences across the world. These are consequences that impact not just the economy, but all of society, from a healthcare, livelihood, business health, and various perspectives. It has led to a significant change in business models, in the acceleration of digitization, but at the same time, several segments of the economy also falling behind. And thus, this is bound to impact and influence the budget proposals. With this as a backdrop, to get clarity on the expectations from the Union Budget 2021, and to get some insight as well as develop a point of view on how the policies of the government would likely shape India's journey in the post-COVID and pandemic world. We are very fortunate to have amongst us today some eminent speakers and experts on the topic. We have today with us Mr. Nilesh Shah, who chairs the Banking, Finance and Capital Markets Committee of the Bombay Chamber and is the Group President and Managing Director, Kotak Mahindra Asset Management Company Limited. Nilesh, welcome. Mr. Asit Bhatia, Managing Director, Global Corporate and Investment Banking, Bank of America. Asit, welcome.
Thank you.
Mr. Rajiv Anand, Executive Director, Axis Bank. Welcome to Rajiv. And the session will be moderated by Mr. Uday Bhansali, who is President, Financial Advisory, Deloitte. And thus, these are folks have been given a big introduction that I can walk all of you through, dear participants, but I will not. None of these people need significant introduction at all. And I don't want to use up more time. So I will turn it over immediately to Mr. Nilesh Shah to deliver the keynote, and then over to Uday immediately after that to lead the session and the panelists into an interactive discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anjali. Good afternoon to all the participants. Clearly, we have seen the worst of the economic crash and optimism in last 12 months. Our GDP contracted for June quarter by about 24%, one of the highest in the world. And now it looks like December quarter will see marginally positive GDP growth. Month on month, things have improved. GST collection at all-time high level. E-way bill generation 16% higher than last year, indicating that this is becoming a broad-based recovery. If not, it is already a broad-based recovery. FX reserves, including forwards, will be upwards of $600 billion all-time high. Power consumption at 1,83,000 megawatt is all-time high. Google Mobility Index, FastX collection, all are pointing towards a recovery which is gaining momentum. And the best thing for India is that COVID-19 active cases are below 2 lakh. And every day that number keeps on reducing slowly and steadily. In this backdrop, budget is coming. Obviously, delivery of budget will have to take into account political considerations, farmer agitation. So you have no option but to mention rural, agriculture, farmer in the budget several times. There is border tension with China. Obviously, you have to mention about defense in the budget. But within this delivery, the content should be growth oriented. We have never before seen kind of opportunity in the post-COVID-19 world. In 80s, India and China were of similar size. Today, China is 5.5 times bigger than us. While we became back office to the world, we were left behind in becoming manufacturer to the world. Today, we have an opportunity to close the gap with China. We can become manufacturer to the world or some part of the world by becoming part of global supply chain management. Now, how does budget influence this decision-making? I believe Indian manufacturing is uncompetitive on many accounts. The preferred explanation is land, labor, and capital issues. I believe while they are real issues, the real challenge for India is higher logistics cost and higher power cost. The agriculture subsidy burdens on industrial power, making our manufacturer pay higher power cost than what a Japanese manufacturer is paying. In logistics, world over, bulk of cargo moves via sea, water, and railway transport. In India, bulk moves via road transport. It's not that we don't have railway network, but passenger fare subsidy continues to burden railway freight, making it uncompetitive. If in this budget, a step can be taken in the direction where passenger fare subsidy is subsidized by the budget rather than being burdened on the railway freight, and if agriculture power subsidy is paid out of the budget, both at center and state level, and is taken out of the industrial power, then that will make India hugely competitive. I don't think so we can expect it to happen in one budget, but let's move 5, 10, 15, 20% in that direction so that 5 years down the line, Indian manufacturing becomes as competitive as the world with competitive power cost and logistics cost. These are the kind of steps which we require in the budget to make this a dream budget. There are also talks about regularizing dividend taxation like before, because it's triple taxation on corporate. Companies pay tax, then when they distribute dividend, they pay tax. And when the individual receives dividend, they pay tax. This kind of triple taxation needs to be reduced. There's also clamor that long-term capital gain benefit should be restored. However, more than the dividend taxation and long-term capital gain tax, what market needs is a growth-oriented budget. We need finance minister to achieve trinity of impossible. One, raise resources, but don't raise taxes. At 43% maximum marginal rate for individual, it's highest in the world or one of the highest in the world. Second, please spend money to support that segment of economy which has been hit hard by COVID-19. Construction, real estate, tourism, retailing. There are many sectors which need stimulus. And finally, maintain the path of fiscal prudence so that investors get confidence on our macros. How do you achieve this trinity, raising resources, spending money, and yet maintaining path of fiscal prudence? I want to focus more on raising of resources because when our incomes were down in first 6 months of this financial year, our spending also came down. World over, government spent more money than previous year, but we in first 6 months spent less money than previous year. Our root problem remains with raising of resources without raising taxes. The first and the simple thing is something like gold amnesty scheme. In this century, we have spent close to $373 billion for official import of gold. Add gold smuggling and jewelry, which is worn by travelers from Middle East, the number could be $500 trillion at cost in first 21 years of this century. Bulk of this gold remains in Tijori away from mainline economy. If through an appropriately structured amnesty scheme, which passes Supreme Court test And it provides an opportunity for individuals to convert their tijori gold into white economic gold. Government gets taxes and businessmen's balance sheet gets equity capital. This could be hugely supportive of growth. The second thing could be monetization of government's assets, defense land, railway land, transmission towers, roads. All this could be monetized through REITs in which kind of structure and raise money from global investors at attractive rates. The government also sits on custodian of enemy property assets. While India and Pakistan took or enacted this legislation in the late 60s, Pakistan sold off all their enemy property in 1971. We are 49 years behind Pakistan in liquidating custodian of enemy property assets, which probably includes iconic property like Jinnah House in the most stony area of Mumbai. 9,000 properties, maybe they are disputed, maybe there are title issues, but that's worth 100,000 crore plus at 2014 valuation. We need to monetize assets of the government to raise resources so that we can fund spending without raising fiscal deficit. The third thing could be legalizing gambling and betting. We all know gambling exists in India through various formats. We all know betting exists in India during election time, during IPL time, during cricket matches and others. Today, they are underground industries probably supporting criminal activities. But if we regularize this industry from criminal industry, they'll become responsible industry. They will start paying taxes to the government and they will create employment. And most importantly, it will undercut the funding to the criminals. How big this gambling betting industry could be? Let me give you an example of Kerala. In Kerala state, people spend more money on buying of lottery every year than what they deposit in banks by way of fixed deposits. 80% plus non-tax revenue of Kerala comes from the lottery profit. If Kerala Lottery was a listed company, based on 2018 published profitability, even in 2020, it will be top 50 profitable companies in India. This is just one state spending money on lottery. Now, betting, gambling are not necessarily akin to lottery, but they are all in similar direction. If we bring all these underground industries into white economy, you will be able to raise taxes significantly. Tax loopholes. There are n number of tax loopholes which are being exploited by taxpayers and which creates unfair distribution of taxation burden. To give you a small example, today there is a cottage industry where zero coupon debenture, which is listed for 13 months, helps convert interest income into capital gain. Interest income gets taxed at 43% maximum marginal rate. Long-term capital gain will get taxed at 10%. Now, why do we allow such kind of simple loopholes? If we bring top 10 chartered accountants of India together and request them to plug tax loopholes, like ethical hackers help companies plugging loopholes in their programming, I'm sure we will be able to raise India's tax to GDP ratio by a percentage point. There are numerous ways in which government will be able to raise resources without raising taxes. They will be able to integrate underground economy with mainline economy. They will be able to bring savings locked in tijori to banking system, and that will create growth opportunity. Before I stop, it will be unfair on my part if I don't talk about divestment. In 2004, if I remember correctly, PSU index made a top. From that level, PSU index today is down about 52%. In the same time period, Sensex has multiplied several times. Effectively, PSUs have underperformed market over the last 15 years by a big margin. Today, when broad market trades at almost 3 times price to book, PSUs as a unit trades below book. nothing explains derating of PSUs than this. Now, clearly, if government pursues path of strategic divestment rather than market divestment, government creates public-private partnership for PSUs which they don't want to divest. Government creates administrative flexibility and sufficient incentive for top management of PSUs. I'm sure all this can come together to re-rate PSUs. If PSUs go back to their historically high valuations, then government stands to be the biggest gainer. Their portfolio of holding in PSUs, which is roughly about 8 lakh crore today, could easily grow to 16 lakh crores if the same PSU starts trading at their all-time high valuations. I don't think so. Overnight PSU can be re-rated, but certainly we can make a bottom of PSU valuations through measures of strategic divestment, public-private partnership, and administrative flexibility, and thus create enough resources for government to fund budget spending over a period of time. At the end of the day, we need a budget which is growth-oriented, which raises resources without burdening citizens on taxation side, which spends money to support needy sector of the economy, and yet at the same time assures investors that India will not move from the path of fiscal prudence. This undoubtedly looks a tall task, but if this government and this finance minister will not make an attempt towards it, who else will make it? With this, I'll end my talk. Over to you, Uday.
So thank you, Nilesh, for those wonderful ideas. And what we'll do is now pose a few questions to our panel, which will include Nilesh. I'm sorry, somebody, there are repairs going on in my building and they chose this time to come right outside my window. So you'll kindly bear with me. So let me start with Asit first. And, you know, amongst the broader policy proposals that we expect to hear at the FM speech, I thought I'll just pick up the subject of the bad bank. There's a lot of buzz about bad bank nowadays in the media. There are sort of antagonists and protagonists. Is that an idea that's time has come or we've missed the bus? What could be some of the prerequisites, global learnings, and how can we make this succeed in our context? Over to you, Asit, and then I request Rajiv to also support.
No, thanks, Uday. I think it's a very, very relevant question and particularly relevant, post-COVID, because we will see, portfolios of banks, definitely deteriorating, at least over the next, few quarters. But ultimately, the way I think about a bad bank and a good bank is it's ultimately capital allocation that the government of India has to do, correct? The way we've done it traditionally is we've gone out and recapitalized the Indian banking system. And therefore, the good bank and the bad bank continues to effectively remain together, and the government is recapitalizing the banks. But if you look at the way this is being done or has been done maybe for the last 25, 30 years, across the world, and I still remember when I started my career, at Bank of America way back in the late 80s. I mean, there was a Mellon Bank in the US, and they actually created a separate bad bank. It went through a lot of pain, getting Federal Reserve, approval. To get it done, but it did, it did happen. And then similarly, then you had in the 90s, where you had some of the European banks, passing some of their portfolios into bad banks. And we had the Asian crisis where Indonesia did the same thing. And then even in the global financial crisis in 2008-09, even a bank like Bank of America and Citi actually transferred some of their, for example, mortgage portfolios into bad banks. So conceptually, this is something that has been used, very, very well globally. I think India hasn't used this this method of segregating, a good and a bad bank. But we've got to be very, very careful, when you go down that path. Now, obviously, one of the reasons that you do want to do it is that the good bank is the one that lends itself to growth. It lends itself to the process of growth, to lending business, and then there's a separate skill set that is required, and therefore let's talk about a project management skill all right, to manage what the bad portfolio, you know, of that bank is. Now, when you do that, all right, the first thing that we need to be very, very careful about, and that's a bit on global learning here, is that it's not used as, you know, taking additional or bad risk, all right? It's looked at a corrective action rather than, you know, something that, hey, listen, you know, there's going to be a bad bank. Let me take on additional risk, and you know, somebody's going to take care of this problem 3, 4, 5 years down the road. So that's something that has to be, you know, ingrained into the system. The second thing, you know, which is very, very important is when you're actually transferring assets from the good bank to the bad bank or that portfolio, it has to be fairly valued, because again, the last thing you want is an overvaluation of those assets and becomes a larger, you know, a larger problem. But when it's fairly valued, all right, then it gives the ability of the people who are managing the bad bank, and the government could also be a stakeholder. You know, maybe that gives the confidence, you know, the government is behind it as a minority or a significant minority stakeholder, you know, in that bank. So the valuation of that portfolio is exceedingly important. And therefore, also the investors into that bank are people who are experts, you know, in managing that portfolio. So conceptually, where I come out is, I think this is probably as good a time as any for the government to consider creation of a bad bank. I think there are enough experts globally. This is a time-tested stuff that we've seen, you know, seen in the more developed markets, and it's something that we should definitely, you know, consider. But that's my view, Rajiv. If you have stuff to add to what I just said.
So let me play the devil's advocate on this one. And, you know, while I do agree with most of the stuff that Asit has mentioned, the total book is about 1,25,000 crores, give or take a little bit. RBI itself says that stress is somewhere in the vicinity of about 14.8% in a super stress situation. So clearly we have a problem. One could argue on whether the RBI estimate of 14.8% of bad loans is correct or not. But let's leave that out for a moment. In which case, we do have the next cycle, you know, playing out perhaps more from the retail side than from the corporate side. The bad bank idea I've been hearing for about 10 years now. So if you think about what Asit just mentioned, that ultimately, there has to be a transference of these bad assets at a fair value so that the bad bank then can consolidate everything and work on it as a single entity, et cetera, et cetera. If you're going to transfer assets from the good bank to the bad bank at market, in which case the whole exists anyway, in which case the recapitalization needs to happen, and then we're back to square one. I mean, if the government had money to recapitalize, then it would have done it anyway. So therefore, to that extent, I'm really not sure how the bad bank is going to work. Two is, look at the ARC example. I mean, we've had ARCs around for many, many years, and they've had limited success in terms of, I mean, ultimately, what you're looking for is an ARC, but of a much larger scale and size. We're hoping that some of the foreign money will come in, and we will get experts to help resolve some of these issues. I mean, I think the same argument you could use for the ARCs who've been around for many years. They have not been able to scale, you know, the kind of resolutions that we've been able to get doesn't inspire confidence that the bad bank is going to do something miraculous as far as we are concerned. What I'm actually quite bullish on is that the existing resolution framework, you know, through the IBC and CLT process, is now, you know, give or take a little bit, about 3 to 5 years into operations. There has been a lot of case law that's got settled over the last 3 to 5 years, which has, in a sense, created a wonderful framework, a wonderful foundation. And as a banker, I can confirm that the behavior or the relationship between the borrower and lender has fundamentally changed post IBC and CLT. And it is now proven that it is possible for everybody in this country to lose their prized assets if the account is delinquent. And I think it is really that fear, which hitherto didn't exist, which has fundamentally shifted the relationship between the borrower and lender. And so therefore, if that framework already exists, why don't we give it more time? We've done all the hard work over the last 3 to 5 years and use that framework to push for resolution within the NCLT framework. Yes, I do know that we need to increase the amount of infrastructure that the NCLTs have, which is, you know, I think is something that we can easily do to be able to adhere to some of the timelines, etc. I do believe that that framework exists, and I think we should be really using that framework. And as you talk to some of the distressed debt players across the world, it is really this framework that gives confidence that there is a fundamental shift in the distressed debt market in India, which should be able to push money in. I am not so sure that a bad bank, which is, you know, sort of in some shape or form is going to be driven by the government, is going to inspire the same level of confidence. Let me just stop.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajiv. So post-COVID, of course, you know, dealing with distressed debt is going to become very important. Let me just switch gears to another subject, you know, post-COVID, the need to create jobs and, you know, need to have a, you know, capital expenditure. And that in turn needs, you know, financing of that capital expenditure and long-term financial institutions. Now, you see that despite specialist institutions like IFCL, NHAI, REC, PFC, you still find that the banking system is actually the biggest lenders, biggest financiers for long-term financing. Now, you know, post-COVID, as we, you know, seek to recover and thrive and, you know, put the whole vaccine, you know, the whole pandemic behind us, you know, on long-term financing, is there something innovative in terms of policy measures that the government should be, you know, putting out? And, you know, hopefully we hear about this in the FM speech.
What are your thoughts, Rajiv? The National Infrastructure Pipeline envisages spending of about 100 lakh crores, which is a huge amount. And, you know, assuming 25 lakh crores of equity, you're still talking about 75 lakh crores of long-term project financing. I don't think if you look at the way the bank balance sheets have played out over the last 10 years or so, there has been a fundamental shift away from long-term lending to more granular retail-oriented businesses. And so therefore, even a bank like Axis, you know, 15 years ago was 20% retail. Today, it's almost, you know, 55-odd% retail. And so therefore, in that sense, most banks have shifted their focus. And I think it's also fair to say that over the last, you know, 10 to 15 years, the experience of the banking sector within project finance in terms of lending long, creating those asset liability mismatches, dealing with regulatory and execution risk, the experience hasn't been very good. So therefore, to believe that this next cycle of infrastructure funding will get driven by the banks is not going to happen. And I think the sooner that we recognize that, the better it is. And I think one of the things that is clear, and I think Nilesh mentioned that as well, in terms of the speed with which FX reserves are growing in this country, most of the world is working on, you know, sort of 0% interest rates. There is commitments from central banks across the world that interest rates will continue to remain low over an extended period of time. So therefore, liquidity is not an issue. And I think we need to create innovative vehicles and solutions to be able to attract that money. There is no dearth of money. And the attractiveness of India and Indian infrastructure is also not in question. And so therefore, as you create some of these structures, Nilesh spoke about InvITs and REITs, etc., you're seeing that these are attracting long-term institutional money. We've created the NIIF, you know, primarily to drive equity participation. I don't see any reason why that could not focus on debt as well. And so therefore, I think you will get some money of the 75 lakh crores from the banking system. But I think it is important for us to think about how we're going to attract long-term pension fund, annuity money into infrastructure projects, create innovative solutions like what we did in roads with HAM, et cetera, where the initial risk is being borne by NHAI/the government. And then as the project begins to evolve, then the project risk is being taken on by the private sector, institutional investors, et cetera, et cetera. So I think there are multiple ways to dice and slice this. And so therefore, we will need to certainly create more vehicles to be able to finance this huge, huge requirement that we have. And I think the fact that we need infrastructure is not questioned. And I think one of the beauty of India is that in most other countries, including China, you create the infrastructure and wait for the demand to come. In India, you create the infrastructure today, the demand comes tomorrow morning. And so therefore, as you look at, you know, equity IRRs in India for many of these projects, as you get, you know, sort of the better rated, you know, sort of contractors, EPC guys coming in, the equity IRRs are actually a very, very attractive in India. And I'm very confident that our ability to attract the best EPC contractors and let them compete against our best, which is L&T, is something that we should certainly do. And that in turn will attract long-term money.
Okay, so thanks, Rajiv. Maybe Asit, from your vantage point of a global institution like America, is no, there a lot of foreign money waiting to come into, you know, infra financing, you know, into India? What's your take to supplement what Rajiv said?
So I would agree. All right, I think project financing is as a lending activity over the years has actually started coming off a little bit. Unfortunately, I think there was a lot of project financing, you know, happening towards the, particularly in India in the mid 90s and 2000. But I think it started coming off, particularly from the banking system. But I like what Rajiv basically said, all right, that, I mean, what we've seen on the road sector, we're now seeing, for example, in the power sector, that, you know, you've got an initial amount of financing that is coming in from domestic institutions. But thereafter, as soon as the project is ready, it's pretty much structured and pushed out into the offshore bond markets. And I must confess that there's a tremendous amount of liquidity that is available, you know, in the offshore bond markets to fund this. I mean, the kind of stuff that we've been seeing in terms of liquidity, every transaction that you now do is probably setting record lows in terms of, you know, spreads and overall coupons. Every transaction that you do is getting subscribed multiple you know, times. We've seen renewable power companies in India, you know, once the project is up and running, they're short dated. You know, it takes 9 to 12 months for a renewable power project to be up and running. Once it's done, they put these companies or SPVs into restricted groups, you know, create a pot of assets, which is then sold, you know, into the offshore bond market and rapidly used to repay loans. That structure is actually working well. So to answer your question, that there is a significant amount of liquidity, you know, available in the offshore, you know, offshore markets, limited for project finance. But once it's well structured, I think you can get deals done exceedingly well.
Okay. Thank you, Asit. So, you know, since we are talking of innovative ideas, and, you know, Nilesh started this session with a bunch of wonderful ideas, and he did mention that, you know, we are sitting on $600 billion approximately of Forex reserves. Now, any thoughts, you know, this, given the COVID, you know, the pandemic and the urgent need to recover and, you know, spend money or put money into people's hands, is there anything innovative, Nilesh, that you can think that what could we do to our foreign reserves, you know, Forex reserves?
So there are multiple options. One model is to follow Swiss National Bank. Few years ago, on a similar reserve like India, Swiss National Bank reported a profit of $50 billion. Apparently, they were one of the largest owners of Apple in the Apple company. Now, these are ways which will not be suitable to us, because after reporting $50 billion profit, they did report $30 billion loss. In India, we'll go berserk with this kind of attitude. But I think what is worth doing is to diversify our reserves through professional fund managers into investment-grade assets instead of just pure government securities and World Bank securities. We can probably trust some professional fund managers to generate slightly higher rate of return on this diversified set of reserves.
Yeah, so I think you have to put this money to work, you know, rather than just staring at it on the balance sheet and earning minimal returns. So yeah, certainly that's a suggestion that the government could take up. Moving to the next topic that I had on my list, insurance, and you know, 74% FDI in insurance, you know, is that long overdue? Rajiv, any thoughts from your side?
I think if you look at financial services, 100% FDI is allowed in mutual funds. 74% is allowed in banks. So I see no reason why insurance is the holy cow and why it's taken us so long to get to, you know, 74%. And I think post-pandemic, I'm not so sure whether they require the capital at this point in time, but I think given the penetration levels in this country, insurance is certainly a growth sector here. And I think at some point in time, the requirement of capital for the insurance sector will certainly be necessitated. And so therefore, to that extent, this is something that we should certainly, you know, push for. Just, you know, sort of, let me just quickly add one point here. I think we clearly require capital. I think there is no doubt in anybody's mind that we require capital. There is ample liquidity available globally. And so therefore, we should actually be looking at our laws and legislations to see how we can make it easier for foreign money to be able to invest in India. And so therefore, if it means that insurance needs to go to 74%, so be it. But I think it is, I think, important for us to look at some of the other sectors as well to see how we can open up those for capital that is, you know, so precious.
Okay. Rajiv, another sort of phenomenon that we have seen in COVID is the whole rise of digital payments. And, you know, digital payments are here to stay. I mean, you know, the penetration levels, the statistics, the different, you know, the umbrella institution that the government is going to create to, you know, regulate this and, you know, allocate, you know, business. So all this is here to stay. But the thought arises that, you know, how there's a mushrooming of fintechs, and, you know, every bank is announcing its own sort of, you know, app to try and, you know, keep all the and aggregate all their customers and route all the business. But, you know, is that the most efficient way of doing it? And, you know, how do banks and fintechs work more, you know, closely together in a sort of a post-COVID era? And is there something that, you know, say from a policy perspective, that the government should be putting forward? I mean, any thoughts on that, Raj?
So, yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, one of the things that we've learned is the fact that I think we were able to deal with COVID because of the fact that, you know, most banks, including Access, were investing in digital capabilities to be able to serve the customer anytime, anywhere, was something that was a path that banks went down, not over the last 3 months, but over the last, you know, 5-7 years. What has happened, one, by the trigger of demonetization and now COVID, has been that the acceleration of adoption has been phenomenal. And earlier, you know, if you said that, you know, payments were used more by urban, now you're seeing that in tier 6-7 cities, you know, people are using their mobile phone, et cetera, to make transactions, payments, et cetera. And look at it also from the perspective of, I mean, it's not just banks, but, you know, people are buying. I mean, if you look at the data of Amazon and Flipkart, people are buying on Amazon and Flipkart all the way down to the last pin code. And, you know, most of them are actually making payments through the Amazon Flipkart app as well, digitally. So if you see, earlier for Amazon and Flipkart, almost 60-65% of their purchases used to be cash on delivery. That number is now down to 25-30%. So therefore, to that extent, you know, the adoption and the confidence that I can now do more and more of my transactions digitally has just got accelerated through COVID. And I think, you know, the fact that we went down this road, we created the India stack, which is, you know, Aadhaar, the mobile, and Jan Dhan, has ensured that we have been able to deal with this. Similarly, you know, please remember that even this Zoom call would not be possible without the telecom networks that we have created. So we have a huge shout out to Airtel and Vodafone and Reliance Jio, you know, for helping us do this. Without that network, we wouldn't have been able to do all that we are doing today. But to the question that you're asking, I think banks anyway are down this road and will continue to see how we can do more and more of our transactions digitally. I think we are well down that road as far as retail is concerned. There have been significant beginnings that have happened as far as SME is concerned. But I think it is fair to say that the corporate part of our business is underrepresented as far as digital and data is concerned. And I think that those are, you know, some of the things that will get accelerated as we go forward. The way that we think about this is I think when I remember in the early days of digital and fintech, fintech and banks, you know, thought of each other as competitors. And I think that whole attitude has, you know, certainly changed on both sides. The fintech recognizes the fact that yes, they have the capability, technology capabilities, but they don't have the customers, and vice versa. And so therefore it is a synergistic relationship that has now emerged between banks and fintechs, where banks are continuously engaging with the fintech community to be able to create or get solutions that they will be able to do their business better, or, you know, reduce fraud or create a differentiated experience for their customers. So I think it is a great experience. I mean, like us, most other banks are working with fintechs, not necessarily startups, but fintechs, to be able to, like I said, create a differentiated experience. We are also working with the giants. I mean, so therefore, if you look at Google Pay or Amazon Pay or WhatsApp Pay, all those are ultimately the front end, and all the pipes are being provided by the banks. And so ultimately they sit on the technology and digital infrastructure that the banks have created. And that's the other partnership. And we are now taking that partnership to the next level, where there is only, today it's only about payments, but it is now more about being able to cross-sell more and more of our products, personal loans, credit cards, create a co-branded credit card, and so on and so forth, to, on, you know, some of these platforms as well. I think it's a very exciting space. And I think it's fair to say that the relationship between fintechs and banks has, you know, significantly changed over the last 5-7 years. And it's one of collaboration. And I think as you've also seen, the government's focus on this community of startups, there's been a new council that's been created. I think everybody recognizes the strength and the energy that this community brings, and that we can actually do a lot of things, not just in financial services, but across the spectrum in healthcare, for example, as we think about the use of technology and startups.
So we have a lot of questions. So I'll just ask one final question, and that's to Nilesh. You know, our finance minister has promised that we are going to see a budget like never before, right? So from a capital markets perspective, Nilesh, you know, to create that, you know, that dhamaka, that explosion in the, you know, amongst the investing community, business community, corporate world, what are your thoughts? You know, what would be on your dream list from a capital markets perspective?
So one is the short-term impact, which may not last long, and second is the real long-term impact. So my recommendation is to go for game changer in the long term rather than praise in the short term on the budget day. And if economy does well, markets will do well. People won't mind paying taxes as long as it is on the profit and in a fair manner. So let's try to focus on increasing size of the economy, increasing pie of profits for corporate India and citizens of India, and tax it fairly. Net-net capital market will be boosted for long term if we create a growth-oriented budget.
Okay, thanks, Nilesh. What I'll do is now just open up my chat box and you know, pose a few questions, and I'll ask one of the panelists to respond. One of the questions from Mr. Uday Khanna is that we need to analyze, despite global liquidity and opportunities in India, why is there limited FDI to China? Who would like to volunteer to answer that?
Why is there limited
FDI in India? Asit, you want to take that on?
You know, slightly different view, I must say, that I think last year we had a record, you know, amount of FDI coming into India. I must confess, a lot of it was also on the back of all the capital raise that that Jio or Reliance, you know, had done. But I think a couple of things that are happening, my view. All right, number one, India has always been a land of promise, and quite honestly, now even more so. So when I talk to our global counterparts, all right, they're actually seeing, you know, India becoming more and more center stage. And I think we're getting the benefit, unfortunately or fortunately for us, because China has become a bit of a no-no. So the way I see it is, last year was, I don't know the number, but I think something in the $50-60 billion in terms of, you know, FDI, you know, range. And I think we are now at the cusp of getting, you know, more and more of FDI into India. And it's not only, you know, in the past, it's largely been in the whole consumer tech, internet, you know, space. I do hope that this now goes into, you know, more traditional industries too. But I slight difference here is, I actually think India has got a fair share of FDI, even in, you know, in a global environment in which most countries were actually protecting, you know, their own economies. So, and I hope this only get better from 2021
onwards. Yeah. No, Asit, I mean, I would just echo your thoughts. You know, I read in The Economist a few years ago that India is regarded perennially as the economy that has the maximum potential. And last year in December, you know, when the markets were going gaga, that actually, you know, $17 billion of FII money has come in the month of November.
Yes.
And I was feeling very good with the markets going up, the portfolio going up. And then there was another statistic said that in the same period, while we got $17 billion, China got $1 trillion of global equity flows, equity and debt flows. So that was a very sobering thought, you know, that they're probably getting six times the amount that we do. Anyway, moving on to the next question from Nikhil Singhal. All the ideas discussed till now are in reference to the organized sector. How do we impact the unorganized sector positively to come into the mainstream economy? Just like the example of gold held in a tijori by Nilesh, sir. So Nilesh, any thoughts on that to really bring unorganized sector into mainstream? You talked of gold, you talked of gambling, you know, betting, etc. Anything else you would like?
Today, I'll talk about two success stories, which has lessons of how to bring unorganized sector into mainstream. If you go to a town called Morbi, immediately after Machu Dam busted and destroyed the whole town, it was like complete disaster. The whole town was flattened. The Morbi people then came out with clock industry, tiles industry, and it was kind of a cottage industry. They were using diesel, naphtha kind of fuel. They were not paying taxes. The production was not of great quality. There was exploitation of local resources. Companies were making money, few individuals were making money, but it was not sustainable. One fine day, Supreme Court came and gave an order not to use polluting fuel. The whole industry had to shift to natural gas. Now, based on your gas consumption, using calorific values, you were able to count how much tiles you were producing. On top of it, GST was coming, and it came in 2016. Net-net, the Morbi tiles industry shifted from being cottage industry to becoming formalized industry. Now there was no tax advantage. You had to pay appropriate share of tax. The focus was on creating size and scale focus was on quality, focus was not only on local market, but also to export via sea route into the Middle East. Today, when you travel from Ahmedabad to northern Gujarat, you will see many tiles company having glimmering factories. Their net export is about 4,000 crore. Morbi town has improved significantly in terms of pollution, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of opportunity. I think what Morbi tiles industry did together in terms of focusing on scale, focusing on quality, creating brand for their tiles, that's a roadmap or a benchmark model for many other organized industry. Similarly, when I visited Coimbatore, this is what I heard from their textile association. As we know, Tripur is one of the largest knitwear exporting hub. Now, all these companies have come together to create a common purchasing. They also contribute for common branding. They also have a common industry-wide practices for HR and tax compliance and so on and so forth. They also ensure a fair business dealing with the buyers. Net-net, they are working as small industrial units, but they also have adopted collectively business practices of large industrial unit. Both Tripur and Morbi are examples of how unorganized sectors can adopt to economies of scale, adopt to better managerial practices of organized sector, and slowly transit into organized sector. Concessional financing, etc., is not going to work in upliftment of organized sector. What we need is adoption of market policies, and Morbi and Tripur are shining example of what this can achieve.
Okay. Thank you, Nilesh. Next question I'm going to ask Rajiv. This is from Hitesh Dama. The overall credit growth and hence economic growth, especially for the SME space, what can be done to enhance and facilitate overall entrepreneurial culture and bottoms-up growth?
Super question. I think we need to do whatever it takes to get the MSMEs going. If you look at how many of those MSMEs are within the organized sector and availing of credit from the organized sector, it is less than 10%. And I think what is now happening is that data is now available. So hitherto what we have looked at, banks have looked at this space more as collateralized lending, but rather than look at this as lending against collateral, we need to move to a lending against cash flows. And for us to be able to do that, if the government can provide us APIs of GST data that these entities are paying, income tax data that these entities are paying, that gives us the ability to better understand these entities and therefore be able to underwrite these guys quicker, better, etc. You spoke about the fact that more and more payments are going digital. As it becomes an imperative that these entities begin to accept or have already accepted digital payments, you are creating a digital exhaust, which once again can be used to through data analytics to better understand these customers. And so, therefore, to that extent, if some of these things can happen, I think it is imperative for banks in general, banks, NBFCs, to be able to expand the scope of lending to MSMEs. And we do believe that what we saw with retail over the last 10 years, we are going to see with MSMEs over the next 10 years in terms of the rate of growth and the new technologies and delivery systems that we saw on the retail side over the last 10 years. We'll see something similar on the MSME side as well. I think the other thing that worked really well through COVID and really had a multiplier impact as well was the ECLGS scheme. So therefore, what was happening at the beginning of when COVID hit us in end of March, early April, was that MSMEs were looking for money, banks were not willing to lend. That's really when the government came in with a guarantee scheme of 3 lakh crores. Out of that, about 2 lakh crores has got disbursed. It got the wheels of the economy going all over again, because I mean, April and May really was the worst case scenario. I mean, we saw so many entities with zero revenues during those period, and an ECLGS scheme actually helped. And it was was a really innovative scheme that one got the banks to start lending to perhaps the most vulnerable part of the economy at that point in time. The cost to the exchequer was hopefully will be minimal. And so therefore it was a win-win situation. And if we can create more solutions like that, where in a sense the first loss is being taken by the government, our ability to, you know, sort of bring in more MSMEs will only improve. One, through the use of guarantee schemes like I just spoke about, and two, if you can get more data about them as they pay more GST, income tax, digital payments, etc. I think our ability to move more and more of these guys from the informal sector into the formal sector will only improve. And as far as the MSME itself is concerned, remember that the tailor in your neighborhood market is probably borrowing at, I don't know, 36% a month. And if you can get him down to, you know, 8, 10, 12, 15% from the formal sector, the multiplier impact to him and his business is phenomenal. And I think that's really something that we should all be working on.
Thanks, Rajiv.
Uday, I want to add a couple of things to what Rajiv just said.
Yes, please, Anjali, please.
Yeah. I think one of the positive outcomes of COVID and lockdown has been the acceleration of digitization of segments that were earlier not digitized. MSME is one of them. Rural agri is another one. So forcibly, literally overnight, supply chains had to get digitized. So in addition to everything Rajiv mentioned, the fact that we now have a much larger data network, we actually have now digital information available. It is also incumbent on the MSME segment to some extent to also digitize and become more formal. So there are formalization benefits that are now visible to people and, you know, small entrepreneurs and MSMEs, and particularly on the micro side, that if they pay their taxes, if they avail of formal credit, and if they transact online, then they are actually visible to the formal credit system as also to the formal supply chain system. So that's one thing. Second is large enterprises are digitizing their supply chains, both upstream and downstream. And both upstream and downstream, whether it is suppliers or distributors, the long tail tends to be very small businesses. So there is a benefit to them to digitize as well and formalize. And large enterprises to some extent are also funding it. So they should take advantage of it. And finally, the coming together of the formal ecosystem, whether it is big companies or it is banks and NBFCs, along with startups. So startups, Rajiv, you mentioned government kind of taking some first loss, but a lot of startups are also taking first loss. So in some ways, venture money is going into the first loss. So if you have, you know, the Udans and the Bharat Pays, et cetera, who are investing in actually digitizing the small merchant, that also creates an opportunity for MSMEs as well as for the formal sector to lend to them. So I'll pause.
Right. And in fact, you, Anjali, if you see the recent months, the GST numbers, you know, with the higher collections, that seems to suggest that, you know, more and more smaller businesses are coming into the formalized fold of the economy.
Yeah. And we are seeing government support this, because like UPI, the setting up of UPI and the India Stack facilitated digital payments, and no private sector player could have done it on their own. Similarly, there are at least three other such digital infrastructure rails that are getting set up. And those will also provide impetus in the rural agri ecosystem as well as the MSME ecosystem.
Let me go back to a point Nilesh mentioned in his opening remarks. Which was around the, you know, the whole resource mobilization program of the government and the need to monetize a whole bunch of assets. Now, we have seen that the government has made a start, you know, in the divestment of certain flagship PSUs like, you know, BPCL and hopefully Air India now, you know, finally happening, and a few other names which are at various stages of the process. So, again, a question to Nilesh. You know, as a sort of an outside-in view, what could be thoughts and suggestions to the government to really broad base and accelerate the pace of privatization and disinvestment?
I think when I'm using the liberty, but they need to hire smart bankers like Asit Bhatia. Today, they are selecting investment bankers based on L1. It's the race to the bottom because you will get 1 rupee for doing a transaction. You need professionals to run your program. Now, today I read that in 2020 calendar year, the largest buyer of aeroplanes in the world is an Indian airline. That airline is also the seventh largest airline in terms of capacity in the world. And it is largest outside of US and China. Now, this is the potential of Indian aviation. Why will there be no buyers for Air India? You need professional bankers to position potential of Air India in front of buyers and get the mileage. If you remember, a similar smart banker sold majority control of Maruti Suzuki, which was moving from 50% to 51%. And for that 1% with managerial control, he got a better price from Suzuki than what government had got, selling 26% to 49% in Maruti. I think one has to take divestment very, very seriously. It's a process where you don't show your desperation. You get best intelligent minds on your side. Create a positive projection about the future, which is truthful, which is not a lie. And then try to get the best price. I don't think so. Our strategic divestment has followed this model. Air India had many starts and many stops. BPCL also had similar issues. I think we need to really take this divestment process professionally.
I think, Nilesh, I mean, I would only observe there that, you know, being part of this at very close quarters, I think the government has access to every smart banker and every institution knocking on its door. So I don't think there's any shortage of talent and shortage of, you know, blue-blooded bankers and whoever wanting to work with the government and to, you know, help them in the process. I think my experience so far, it's been more about certain internal decision-making, you know, to ensure the highest standards of transparency and more importantly, no comebacks where we have seen in a hotel transaction which was divested, privatized somewhere in 2004, 2005. You know, Rajasthan, there was a judgment recently, you know, opening up the whole matter, you know, based on certain proceedings from investigating agencies where the officials concerned have long retired. So I think these are the considerations which do take prominence. Clearly, those are not to be wished away in a, you know, democratic society like ours. And I think the issue is probably more about trying to compress the speed and, I mean, compress the timelines and, you know, have the acceleration while at the same time doing a lot of the work, parallel processing and so on to achieve the maximization of value that you talk about. So those would be my thoughts on that. Yeah. So let me continue with another very interesting question that has come up from Nikhil Singhal. What are your thoughts on the impact of technology and digitization on employment stroke unemployment opportunities? And what are the ways to absorb the lacks of youth coming into job markets? Now, I know this is probably, you know, kind of remotely related to the budget and COVID and everything, but would be very interested in hearing the perspective of this eminent panel. Maybe I can request Rajiv for your views and then maybe Nilesh. Yeah. Is there a fear that, you know, digitization is going to reduce jobs, is not going to create opportunities? What's your take on that?
So if you look at this through history, this is not a new problem that we are grappling with. When the Industrial Revolution happened, I mean, basically everybody said machines will replace people. Didn't quite happen. Similarly, when ATMs happened in banks, people said that, you know, there've been no longer a requirement for tellers. Actually, banks opened more branches and there was a requirement for more tellers. So all I want to say is perhaps some of the older jobs will need to be rethought, reskilled. But the fact that we will need a different set of jobs, I think is certainly going to happen. Yes, some of the jobs which are repetitive, mundane, can be done by machines will get replaced, but new jobs will certainly get created.
Echoing on Rajiv's point, when computerization was introduced in banking system, there were lots of protests at PSU banks and hartals and so on and so forth. And today we have seen the computerization into bank. It has not reduced jobs. It has actually increased penetration of banking system. It has created jobs. So we should not be afraid of digitization. If at all, we should be riding the wave of digitization so that we can attract jobs from other parts of the world and bring it into India. Today, we have created world-class properties like RuPay, Aadhaar, Bheem, UPI. Why not monetize this? A Visa, MasterCard is $400 billion market cap company. Why not model RuPay to be emerging markets Visa or MasterCard? Why not model UPI for emerging market benefits and monetize it? So we should be focusing on riding the wave of digitization to get jobs from outside the world into India.
In fact, I would completely second that. You know, very interesting. Only yesterday, we had our global research, thematic research guy who was talking to us that, you know, more and more as we digitize, I think the worry is that, particularly with the millennials and the zillennials, that, you know, would there be enough jobs for them? But his point was exactly what Rajiv and Nilesh are saying. The idea creation, the idea generation, you know, is going to be a lot more as we go forward. So in fact, we have to embrace this rather than be worried about it.
Actually, as a country, we have to, if you think about what should be the ask from the budget, is support for skilling and reskilling and a different type of skilling. So it is less about college degrees and more about useful skills that are required from the workforce of the future. So if digitization is definitely here to stay, then creating those digital skills, and it's not just coding. It doesn't have to be just coding. I mean, think about what happened with Y2K. The computerization is what created the entire software industry in India, the software services industry in India. So why can we not create the offshoring of fiber, for example, which suits India really well? It does not require manufacturing. It is white collar skills of the type that India is very good at producing. So why should we not have the next 5 or 10 fibers coming out of India, for example? And entrepreneurship is definitely one part of the solution set. Why create 12 million jobs? Why not at least half of those are entrepreneurs who are themselves creating more jobs?
Oh, absolutely, Anjali. And I think the use of what we have not been very good at is creating infrastructure all the way down to the villages, right? It is very difficult for them to get, I mean, even now we're struggling to get electricity to down to the villages, et cetera, but what we've been very good at is creating digital infrastructure. I remember Nilesh once saying that humko road banana aata nahi hai, but we, in 1994, we created the world's best stock exchange. And remember, over this period, the New York Stock Exchange shut down, the Tokyo Stock Exchange shut down, but the National Stock Exchange never shut down for whatever reason, right? And so therefore, I think we have a skill and capability within this space and the ability to, I mean, we don't create enough doctors, but can we use telemedicine to take the best of medicine down to the villages? And so therefore, I agree completely with what Anjali has said, that we should be actually embracing technology to improve the lives of our people. And that will automatically will create jobs as well.
Okay, Rajiv, thanks. There's a very interesting question from Sunil Bandare. There is a considered view that the FM must announce a revised framework for fiscal responsibility management. Should we go for an expansionist budget with fiscal discipline being given the go-by, for at least 2 to 3 years. What's the view of the panel? So, Nilesh, is this something you would like to comment on?
If I take a shot at it, I don't think so. We have to let go fiscal responsibility and budget management framework. While there is strong case for doing it, because this year, every country is going to let go fiscal discipline. My feeling is that we should adopt Margaret Thatcher's model of United Kingdom in the late 80s. She, you know, was known before she became prime minister as Thatcher, milk snatcher, because she stopped subsidized milk in English schools. Like our midday milk scheme in the 80s, even English kids were getting midday milk in English schools. And she monetized assets of the British government to reduce the size of the government. She raised resources, she spent money to make UK economy stronger, maintain the path of fiscal prudence. And her tenure, UK actually grew at a faster pace than OECD average. We need to do the same thing for India. There are benefits of fiscal discipline. We can raise resources by monetizing our assets, and there's no need to compromise on the spending. We can achieve this trinity of impossible, raising resources without raising taxes, spending money to stimulate needy sector of economy, and yet maintain path of fiscal prudence. Imagine we will become oasis in the desert of the world. One side, world will go towards fiscal indiscipline, and India will be standing on the path of fiscal prudence. It is possible if we are innovative.
Okay. Another question that's come from Hitesh Dama. Any suggestions, any steps to boost consumption and bring optimism back in consumers? Nilesh, you want to take that?
Well, the Indo-Australia match also brought optimism among many cricket players, cricket fans.
Did they spend money? Did our consumers spend money?
See, the mindset was definitely positive. On a serious note, the best way to support consumption could be to give short-term tax break. On an average, our consumption basket is taxed at about 20% GST. Some are at 18%, some are at 28%. Now, if I give 3 months, 6 months concession on that 20% basket, that's going to create a multiplier effect of about 4 to 5 times. So very focused short-term consumption tax benefit could create preponement of demand and create a virtuous cycle where demand will create jobs and jobs will create demand. So that should be considered in the budget.
Okay, thanks.
Uday, slightly different point of view there. I think we should be spending every possible rupee on vaccinations, because I think ultimately what is holding, you know, people like us back, I mean, it is fear. I think if once you get the fear out of all of us, I mean, we'll start to go back to offices, and the next time we can have this in the Taj or whatever it is, there you go, consumption starts to happen. Similarly, we can start to go to restaurants and movies, etc. So I think in that sense, if we can work very, very hard to get the fear out of people, I think consumption will automatically happen. People have anyway saved money because over the last 6 months, you know, like you said, consumption has been relatively low. And by nature, people are social animals. And so therefore, if we can get the fear out of people, I think our ability to, you know, drive consumption just improves. So spend every rupee you have on vaccination, get as many people vaccinated.
Okay. So thanks, Rajiv. And, you know, let me ask a final question to each one of you. Let's assume that Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman had the time and she was quietly listening to our webinar. What would be the one ask from your side that what you would like to see in the budget, and she were to grant that wish? So maybe I'll start with Anjali.
Uday, that was my question. So I'm actually flipping right back at you there. Uday, you haven't spoken. What is your one ask?
No, I would tend to go with what Rajiv said. You know, get us back to work as soon as possible. And, you know, that calls for the mass vaccination program. And if we need to spend, you know, $7 billion or whatever it takes, I mean, it's going to pay for us in multiples. You know, because let's say as a consequence of a very rapid rollout of the vaccine, you know, we get back to work and, you know, social and our life gets back to pre-COVID, say even 3 months before normal or 6 months before normal. Look at the multiplier effect on our economy. I mean, so if you ask me, there should be a complete no stops, no holds barred vaccination program and spending for that. And that's what I would like to see. So maybe I'll ask Asit next.
No, I think you're right. All right. Normalization is something that all of us, you know, wish for. And I think that's the common theme. Well, one of the things, I mean, when I talk to some of my, as Bank of America, we are typically dealing with, you know, the large corporations in India. And, you know, those guys have actually done well, if not better. All right. But when you talk to the second and third tier, you know, companies, I think that's where, and I think Rajiv brought this up very well, the whole MSME sector, that's the sector that needs a bit of, you know, revival and a quicker revival than that. And a focus on that sector will have a multiplier effect again on, you know, on the economy. So besides normalization, which all of us desperately want, I think that's one sector that hopefully, you know, she can focus on, you know, for us and kickstart, really, really kickstart the economy.
Rajiv, any thoughts from you? What's the one wish?
You're on mute, Rajiv.
As the CFO of the country, I would like her to go across every PSU, state and central government ministries and ensure that every rupee outstanding is paid to whoever it's due to be paid. I mean, whether it's an MSME, and that itself, I mean, the number, estimate number that the government owes industry/MSMEs is anything between, you know, 7 to 10 lakh crores. Pay that money and that itself becomes a force multiplier.
Okay. And Nilesh, the final word from you.
So I'll recommend her to read speech of Mr. H.N. Patel, which he made as the finance minister of Janata government in 1977, and implement those things.
Anything notable there we should know about?
H.N. Patel was one of the legendary person in financial world in the 70s. And he talked about vision of India where entrepreneurs are empowered, where government is focused on governance and not becoming part of the economy. And even in 1977, he spoke about what we should be doing, which we haven't done till today. So my recommendation is that free Indian entrepreneur. We are just like Indian cricketers. It doesn't matter whether our team is injured or not. It doesn't matter whether we are playing on the fifth day pitch or not. Just give us the freedom, we'll go and win the match. Free the Indian entrepreneurs.
Okay. Another question's just come in. Any specific, you know, sort of advantages or reliefs for the salaried class? Anything that comes to mind? Maybe Asit, anything you would like to comment on?
Yeah, I think as Nilesh put it, a kickstarter to really demand is a lowering of tax. And you know, I think you spoke about GST, but I also think income tax is something which is which, and maybe I'm biased here, but you know, I think the high taxation rate, particularly for the salaried class, does hurt consumption to that extent. So that's something that unfortunately it's always been the favorite beating boy, you know, beating class of for taxation purposes. So my humble biased view is maybe you know, reduction of tax, you know, on that account, because that will spur up demand, you know, to a certain extent.
And maybe Rajiv, to you, any special incentives for manufacturing, for creating new factories, modernization, anything on that front you think is specifically needed? Any interventions needed?
Ho gaya na. I mean, new factories are getting 15% taxation, etc. There's a PLI scheme. I think it's just a question of implementing all those.
Okay. So I think, Anjali, we've run out of questions. We've had a very, very engaging discussion. Let me hand it back to you for the closing remarks.
Thank you very much. So this has been a wonderful session. I've learned a lot. I will definitely go and read H.M. Patel's speech, Nilesh, and I hope that our FM does too. But lots of food for thought here. And a few consistent themes. I think there is a theme around disinvestment, divestment, monetizing the government's assets, as it were, by whatever name we choose to call it, fiscal prudence, support for MSMEs, the clear consensus that digitization is good. It creates more opportunities than threats, but consequently focus also on inclusion and inclusive growth and thus skilling and providing more livelihood opportunities, not just jobs in that sense. There was something we spoke about, the coming together of large companies, banks, startups, fintech particularly, and again, the theme around digitization. And lots of very interesting anecdotes and stories from all the panelists that make it all so real. So I'm privileged to thank everyone today. So as a formal vote of thanks on the behalf of Bombay Chamber and myself, I extend sincere thanks to all our speakers, to Asit, Nilesh, Rajiv, and Uday for a very, very deft job of moderating and conducting this session and bringing the best out of really the audience as well as our speakers. So thank you all. At Bombay Chamber, we believe in closely engaging and collaborating with our members. So we hope this was value adding to all the people who attended. We also want to thank Kotak Mutual Fund, Tata AIA, and ICICI Bank, who are the session sponsors, for supporting us and making today's webinar possible. We hope to continue working with all of you, as well as our Banking and Financial Services Committee, to focus on issues that impact this industry, but also the Indian economy as a whole. And finally, last but not least at all, heartfelt thanks to Sandeep Khosla, DG Bombay Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and his wonderful team, Dr. Sugita Upadhyay, DD Bombay Chamber. She anchors the BFC committee, Mahadev Margi and Vikram Negi of the IT department, for making today's webinar possible. Thank you all, and look forward to seeing you all soon on some other session.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Cheers. Thank you. Have a good evening. Bye.